So for this episode of Up, I'm here with Richard Vincent, Professor Richard Vincent, cardiologist and author as well. Just talk a bit about what you do in your day job and your career in medicine first.
Yeah, so I've been a cardiologist for all my life and have very much enjoyed both doing cardiology at the hospital in Brighton, or Sussex County, but also got involved with the universities because I was interested in research in cardiology and more broadly.
Yeah, exactly. And I know that's fed into some of your ideas in this book. So what's the marble curse? And how did you get into writing children's books from a career in medicine?
OK, well, it was actually the fault of some of my family who, when they were about the age that the book is directed to, started inventing a few things. And together we played with the various ideas, like a signpost that had legs and could walk and tell you where you're going to go. Or something silly like living in a clock or using it to travel. And it grew from there. And actually, I wrote it because it was so much fun that followed that.
Yeah, and so is this fantasy? Where would we put this? What genre is this book?
It seems... I have a feeling you can't put it in a genre.
All right.
It has got a lot of fantasy and humour, but it also has got real historical things from the 18th century, which is where our two hero and heroine have gone. 1.11, 1.13.
And that's Joe Raven and...
That's Joe Raven, yeah. And Beth Raven.
And Beth Raven, yeah.
And Raven, because the raven is one of the most intelligent problem solvers of the bird world. And what they have been called back to is to solve a problem, the problem of the marble curse.
Yeah, so... Exactly, so just what is the plot for this then?
The plot.
Yeah.
I'll tell you it so far.
Yeah.
Yes, well, they find at least one of Joe's gadgets. He makes gadgets, and they're very advanced beyond our current science. And he's actually got something he calls a spy tortoise, which, while travelling around the garden, found a box, not there before. In the box is a silver bird and also a guidebook, which has got nothing in it, which seems very surprising. But there were two letters, one for Joe, one for Beth. And those letters were inviting them to come and solve this problem of the marble curse. And they had to find that person first. And then they had to discover that she lived in the 18th century. And then they found themselves in the 18th century. And they met up through lots of incidents. And then they had to put together the pieces of the puzzle of how it was that the marble curse was affecting everybody in that village and town. Why was it there? And who's put it together? And for what reason? So the rest of the plot is how they did that. And at the end, you'll have to read the rest of it,
yeah.
Really.
What are the effects of the marble curse and what does it do to...
Oh, what does it do?
Yeah.
Yes, it's awful. You start off thinking are thinking a bit more slowly. And if you're a really nice person, you start getting a bit irritable and cross, and very cross. And then you get starting stiffness all over. And gradually you stiffen up. And eventually you turn into something like marble, which is completely solid. It's not really very nice. And once you're like that, if you were living in that town, you'd be put on the town bridge. Why?
Right, OK. Interesting. Is there anything in the current times that gave you inspiration for this? Is it all in the 18th century? Because you wouldn't want to be around in the 18th century in terms of experiencing healthcare. We were just having a chat off stage about using arsenic in various products, bloodletting,
yes.
It was a time of trial and error in healthcare, wasn't it, back then?
Oh, yes, it was obviously very primitive. Some of the physical sciences were growing, but as you say, the sciences of medicine hadn't got very far. Yes, there were several things, really. Some of the locations of the story are places that I've been to visit, and I felt that they had a character and some various features that one could introduce and knit together for this sort of story. Otherwise, it was fairly thought through about what to research in the 18th century, in terms of social custom and in terms of science, and also to see how we could bring in some modern things in science. So some of the things that Joe does are related to physical properties, physical science, and some are beyond. So it's really a mixture between some real history and fantasy, some real science and some fantastic science. And it was intended to do that, to weave them together. And actually that drove the plot and also featured in how the problem was solved.
Yeah, I mean, children like fantasy, don't they? They like to be transported into a different world. So, yeah. I mean, you know, what else are they getting, these two main characters getting up to?
Well, they're invited to eat something like brown soup when they met a couple of characters who came to sell them, or the owner of the place, some yellow spray, which is very nice. But actually, it turned out to melt the cooking pot. And all sorts of things went wrong after that. They also got rumbled a bit, and some rather unwelcome people managed to capture Beth. And I can't give all the game away about how she got out of that. But yes, they have trials every chapter.
Yeah. I mean, what, growing up, do you remember what fantasies we did? Do you remember reading about fantasy and youngsters like that kind of escapism, don't they, as we were saying? So, I mean, is it kind of based on some of your experiences?
Some of those quite early on, a few that I read later on, which were perhaps more adventures, but they still had this sort of fantastic track going along as well, actually, which is nice. But otherwise, quite a lot of the fantastic seems to come into my mind early in the morning.
Yeah. What got you involved in writing then? What made you turn to writing? Did you always have a book in mind when you were at the medical school there?
No, not really. Right. No, I've written quite a lot in medicine, and obviously a lot of research papers and that sort of thing that you do in that world. This really resulted from this conversation with the younger children, and I found that sort of bringing that together was just so much fun, literally.
Yeah.
I'm afraid.
Yeah, exactly.
No big...
So how did you put pen to paper then? Because we get a lot of authors on this programme, and, you know, I always ask the same question, really, because it's one thing about thinking about writing a book.
Yes.
It's another thing, isn't it? Actually sitting down, having the kind of the discipline to put pen to paper. And...
Yes. I knew what the ideas were going to be in general, very general, and I started actually doing quite a lot of research into how the 18th century ticked, what buildings were like and everything like that. And also visiting different places, one of the National Trust properties over in West Sussex, a place in France. And they triggered some ideas that could grow. So once I got started, and once I'd also sat down literally and thought about overall plot, then I just started writing something that I knew it would begin. And not unusually, that first chapter was discarded. And in fact, the second version was discarded, because when you get further down, you realise that actually you could have started it slightly better. So actually the start of it was written, as it appears in the book, much later in the genesis of the book itself.
Yeah, 3 years in the making, wasn't it, as well then? So, I mean, it's been a long process. How many redrafts have you gone through on this?
I can't count.
All right.
One every day. Not whole drafts, but you can keep altering it and playing with that for a long time.
So, was it easy to kind of get a publisher, and how did you... What was that like, that process? Because a lot of people that are on this programme before, they kind of self-publish nowadays, but I know you've actually got a publisher here for this.
Yes. I think it is demonstrably hard, there's no doubt at all, and I've had rejections before this publisher picked on this one. And actually, it's quite capricious in many ways. And talking to my publishers, they said it's interesting... We look at the book, we think, does it fit what we want to sort of publish? Do we got a hole that we can sell it in? So that's one thing, the book itself, its quality, and could it be sold? There's a lot of marketing thought that goes into whether it's accepted. And the second thing is they're equally interested in the author, because they see quite a tie between getting to know the book and getting to know the author.
Yeah.
And if there's something, you know, of interest in both, then it'll go into the shortlist. And then it gets presented to the marketing people who say, yes, I think this will fly. And another copy editor and says, yes, this is a good story, it's for the right age. So it's quite a battle, particularly as the ratio of success is something like 5 out of 100.
Right, OK. And what's the age range for this? Who's it really aimed at? I know it's children, but is there a certain age range you think it would be...?
Yes, the age range I've stuck to really is 8 to 12. But I have to say, rather amusingly, a number of folks who live near Bleras who are nearer to 100 than they are to 10 have read it with great delight. And I've taken it to a number of independent bookshops. And it's the people owning them. I had a comment just last evening, actually. You know, I thoroughly enjoyed this book. I'm going to give it to someone. So I think it's fairly widely appealing, surprisingly.
Yeah. Before we break for the first half, I mean, where can people get this book? I know it's in at Waterstones in Brighton.
Yes, it's they're open now, as well. The usual outlets. Yeah, so Amazon, as you say, Waterstones, Smiths, Foyles, and a lot of independent bookshops can get it. And Bookshop UK, which is an amalgam of independent bookshops, is very enthusiastic too.
Brilliant. OK, that's it for the first half. I'll be joined again by Richard Vincent for the second half. We'll talk a lot more about the Marble Curse. Join us then. So back here for the vote with Professor Richard Vincent, who is a cardiologist, but also a children's author, particularly first novel, debut novel, The Marble Curse.
Yes.
And we're going to talk a bit about the setting, going back to the 18th century. Why the 18th century out of all of the centuries? What was the inspiration behind that?
Yes, I think it's an interesting time. And I remember going to the Science Museum, which I've often taken some kids to. And there was a big exhibition of scientific apparatus that was collected by King George III.
I think I saw that as well, yeah.
Yes, and that was really very interesting.
Yeah.
Most of it was a sort of mechanics, optics type of level.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of things going on there, wasn't there? And it was, as we said in the first half, a lot of trial and error. So it was interesting. I think science was more of a hobby back then as well, wasn't it, in the 18th century?
Oh, yes.
Rather than a kind of an academic discipline.
It was, oh, yes. Yes.
More people did it in their spare time, so it's quite interesting. Is that have any of the innovations, inventions informed the things that Job in particular plays with the pest torch? what's that?
Yes, the pest.
Yeah.
Well, the pest is really a name for a pan electromagnetic spectrum torch. That certainly wasn't invented then. that's a yet-to-come invention, which Joe seems to have managed to build anyway, which allows any sort of light, X-ray, radio waves, laser beams, to be shot anywhere you like. And the ultraviolet light that it produces, and they did know about that then, the ultraviolet light lit up one of the clues. So, you know, that was that. I guess the biggest contribution was the fact that in that era there was the development of airborne balloons with baskets.
Yeah.
And we had two of those sorts, as perhaps you know, and they originated in France. And one was to do with burning logs, anything you can burn, actually, to cause the hot air to fill the balloon and carry people. It didn't carry people initially. It carried a few animals across Paris and dropped them the other side, which was quite remarkable and had lots of people following it. Montgolfier, they were called. And then there was another version in France, which was with hydrogen. So the chemistry of generating hydrogen from acid and a metal, that was used to generate hydrogen. And they used to have huge bottles, essentially, generating hydrogen, all going into the bottom of this big balloon. Quite big.
Yeah.
And that was equally good at carrying you. In fact, it was probably more efficient than the hot air. And so that weaves its way into there because our two protagonists were in the balloon, in the basket, in the balloon, together with their best friend called Sash. And that took them up into the air.
Yeah.
The problem is, how do you get down again? And the way it's done, the way they'd invented to do that, was just to have a flap at the top of the balloon that you pulled down and the hydrogen would escape and you would come down slowly. So yeah, that was a useful invention for them, without doubt.
Yeah, exactly. And that features in here. What about, are you going to be writing other books, and is it going to look more to the future about innovation, science and innovation in the future? Because there's quite a lot going on.
Well,
there isn't there.
Try to stir some of that in, but I'm quite keen to take these folks back to a different era again, and that would be the 19th century.
Yeah.
Because actually, right at the end of the 18th century to two-thirds, three-quarters of the way through the 19th century was the big development of particularly machinery. And all during that phase, we've got James Watt and steam and...
Yeah.
I mean, that was around, which completely changed society, as you know.
Yeah, exactly. What about teaching children about science? Is that something that you've aimed to do here? I mean, what would you want children reading this book? What would you want them to get out of this? Would you want them to have an interest in science, particularly women, because there's...
Yeah.
You know, we want to get everyone involved in science, just to...
Yes.
It's for everyone, isn't it? It's
very good. Absolutely, yeah. Brilliant women scientists. As you know, one of them found out x-rays on which, you know, a lot of medicines depended.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And didn't get all the credit for it.
Well, that's what happens, actually. It's very interesting to know who really made the idea.
Exactly.
You want to try asking that, actually, of a light bulb.
Yeah.
Was it Edison or was it actually somebody else? And he actually decided to market it in America. Yeah. Anyway, that's another story.
Yeah.
where were we? Yes. Interested in science. Yes. It shows the value of science. And actually, I think without making it too heavy, Joe didn't believe some things that he couldn't explain. And he was very positive about that. I mean, some things happen... And he knows that they couldn't happen.
Yeah.
But then at one stage, he recognises that, and so this is a little bit of sort of science philosophy, that actually you could say that, he doesn't say this, but generally you could say, scientists are people who don't know something, because that's what they're trying to find out. And so there is a line in there which sort of says, well, you know, science says, if I've seen this, then even if I don't understand it, I've got to accept it and stir it into the ways I think science works. So it's this business of actually data being what you do find for real, and if it doesn't fit your expectations, then it doesn't mean that's somehow wrong or just can be pushed to one side. It means you've got to change the way you think about things. I mean, it is, as you like, as daft as saying, well, do you know... The sun doesn't go around the earth. Now, if you stood on the earth and had no idea what's going on, that's very reasonable. The sun comes up there, goes all the way through the sky, and down over there. And so why shouldn't it be the sun going around the earth? And the reason is, of course, you haven't got all the other data which shows things going elsewhere and measurement, etc. So the mindset of the experimenter has to change. And that's happening absolutely all the time.
Yeah.
As you know, there's yet another subatomic particle that seems to have turned up that is going to account for some phenomena we can't explain. And so I think that when somebody did say, you know, scientists are a group of people who don't know something.
Yeah, exactly. And they're trying to find out...
What it is.
What it is.
And how it fits.
Yeah, and I know we're going to save it for a different episode as well, because it's really fascinating topic, I think, as well. So, I mean, you've got... is this going to be... one of many books? Have you got another any more books?
It depends how long I live.
Come out.
There's another one. The way I get to write books is that some people create stuff at some different times of day. I'm a sort of early morning person.
Yeah.
So I sit at my desk and on the window ledge there is a growing pile of pieces of paper with ideas on. So fantasy ideas, theoretical ideas, things about relationships, how I'm going to weave those together. So I spend a lot of time in collecting stuff like that and then see how it shapes. I shall go off and learn a lot more about the 19th century. In some places, detailed social customs. So, for example, in there, Joe is surprised to find that there's no doctor you can go and see with your illness. Oh, no. There's no doctor. You might have somebody like that who will go to the very rich people. You know, we don't have doctors, we don't have schools, we don't have policemen, you know, many of the things. We have apothecaries, whatever they bring. And it's different.
And that changed in the 19th century, didn't it, with the Victorian era and...
yes.
Queen Victoria and all of the kind of the innovations and reforms which happened under Gladstone and...
yes.
Disraeli, Benjamin Disraeli, Prime Ministers.
Yes, and substances were found. And of course, overseas trade, overseas exploration, brought back some things which could be the remedies. I mean, the opiates, you know, got a huge hold there. And yeah. You'd give those to children. You'd put morphine in bottles of medicine for your toothache and give them to a three-year-old. So, you know, it was a lot of learning. And there was also some very seemingly barbarous treatments of people who had epilepsy or mental disease as well.
Yeah, exactly.
We won't have those in the book. Next.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, is there things for children to learn in this book as well, lessons to learn? And, I mean, what should they be taking away into maybe this school life as well? Because obviously science... Yeah. We want to promote science in school life, don't we? We want to make it easy to understand. I mean, are these concepts easy to understand?
Well, I hope so, because they're in part articulated by characters of the right age.
Yeah.
What I do want them to get out of it actually is fun in the first place. It's a fairly high-paced book.
Yeah.
And if anybody chooses to read it, two or three people I know of who've sat down with it, youngsters, 9, 12, that sort of age, one particular person got it at 2:30 in the afternoon, had a text to say he'd halfway through it by 5:30, and another text to say he was finished it by 7:30.
He's faster than me.
I know, it's incredible. Yeah. And two other folks I know sat down and read it from 9 o'clock till 12 o'clock and had lunch. What I would suggest, if you are inclined to do that, that you read it again, because actually reading it a second time, there is enough in it to pick up more things than you might imagine, and particularly clues in the front half of the book, which you then can see how they've worked out later on.
We're going to have to leave it. They've run out of time, so it's a Marble Curse, and it's all available, Waterstones, it's Boyles, Amazon, you name it, you can get it. It's a Marble Curse.
Yeah.
Professor Richard Vincent, thanks for coming today. All the best.
It's a pleasure.
Thanks a lot.